William Morrow and Harper Audio present The London Bookshop Affair, a novel of the Cold War, by Louise Fein, performed by Marisa Calin. To Julian, my island in stormy seas. Any fool can start a war, and once he's done so, even the wisest of men are helpless to stop it, especially if it's a nuclear war. Nikita Khrushchev. Prologue. Genie. London, February 1942. The air was choking, thick with a heady mix of cologne, sweat, liquor, and smoke from 100 lucky strikes. So many couples were packed onto the dance floor of Feldman's swing club, jiggling, swaying to the big band, it was impossible not to collide with one another. Who cared? Not Jeannie. Cheeks aching from so much smiling in one evening, toes clamped into the vice-like grip of her two-sight dancing shoes, skirt flying as she swept around the floor. How many hours had she been on that dance floor? She'd lost track. But even after a 10-hour shift in the cafe, she wasn't ready for the night to be over. She never wanted it to end. The gleam of trumpet, saxophone, clarinet under the low lights, the heat, the illicit feel of the place. But most of all, the proximity to Harry. A wave of dizziness as the band segued into a new, slower beat, and Jeannie drew closer to Harry's arms, intoxicated by the smell of him. The rough feel of his uniform against her cheek, the brush of his chin on her hair. She closed her eyes. The bold, bright sound of the music throbbed through her, spoke to something primitive deep inside. She was lost to him. She'd met him only 2 weeks ago, but in times of war, when every minute of every day was precious and stretched out for as long as it could be, when they wished they never slept, it had been enough. In 5 days, Harry would be gone, back to the USAAF station 1101, Dawes Hill, Buckinghamshire. Although it might as well have been the moon, it felt so far from Oxford Street, this club, and Jeannie's life. Her life, which had been turned upside down by this GI's arrival. It was as though she'd been asleep for all her 19 years until Harry Marshall marched in with his wide smile, his deep dark eyes, and his captivating soul and woke her. Nothing, not mother or work or sensible thought, would keep her from him until the very last moment when he had to return to his squadron. The music paused and Harry released her. He cupped her chin with one gentle hand.
You hungry, sweetheart? I'm not sure how much longer I can stay upright without food.
Now you mention it, yes, and my feet are killing me. What I'd give to sit down.
Come on, I know a place.
With an arm slung around Jeannie's shoulders, he led her outside into a frigid February night. They walked toward Piccadilly, bodies in sync. Somewhere, a clock struck the half hour. Jeannie hoped Mother hadn't waited up.
You ever tasted American waffles?
Harry asked. Jeannie stole a glimpse of his profile in the semi-darkness. The moon was full and the night clear. Her heart tilted. Not yet.
Then you're in for a treat.
The recreation rooms at Rainbow Corner were a little slice of America. A home away from home for the troops. Pinball, jukeboxes, Coca-Cola, slouchy sofas, Yankee voices filling the space between the walls. How she loved them, all of them, here in their vital, high-octane, high-energy wholesomeness, come to save them from the Nazis. And the Rainbow Corner, it was young and vibrant. Jeannie wanted so much to be a part of it, this bright, bright place. A world away from ground-down London, her parents' stuffy, hard-backed furniture, dark wallpaper, coal fires, oil lamps, and hardship. Harry steered Jeannie to a table with a check tablecloth and went to fetch the food. Glenn Miller was playing on the jukebox. Jeannie crossed her legs and tapped her foot to the rhythm, staring around the laughter-filled room, trying to look as though she belonged. "What time does this place close?" she asked when Harry returned. It must be nearly midnight.
Never.
Harry smiled.
It's open 24 hours, 7 days a week.
just like New York.
He laughed and thrust a hamburger at her. Here, your first taste of the US of A.
There was a plate of waffles to share after, and Coca-Cola in glass bottles full of bubbles that went up her nose, making her cough and splutter. Such plenty here, in a land of rationing and shortage. God bless America, Jeannie said, laughing, savoring the sweetness of the waffles on her tongue. She looked at Harry, smiling at her, the warmth in his eyes. Hope blossomed like spring. It will all be different now that you're here. England, are so happy, so grateful. She swallowed. I'm so happy. Harry, you are the best thing that's ever happened to me. Harry gazed back at her, eyes gleaming in the lamplight. Then suddenly he looked serious. Marry me, Jeannie, he said. What? Jeannie dropped her fork. A piece of syrupy waffle flew off and landed with a squelch on the table between them.
I mean it, baby, Harry said, ignoring the waffle. I've never felt this way before, never. And I know you feel it too. When the shit show is over, I'll take you back to New York. We'll live in style, up in a high rise, and have babies. And, well, you can do whatever you want. I promise. I'll make you happy. Just say yes, little darling. Just say yes.
He looked scared suddenly, vulnerable, like a small boy. Waiting for one three-letter word from her that would determine his future. Jeannie wondered for a moment if he'd left anyone special behind. If this was just a ruse to get her into bed. She knew it happened. Father had warned her about men who seduced young women more times than she'd had hot dinners. She'd gotten so used to it, she barely even heard him anymore. But staring into Harry's eyes, she wondered, a tantalizing, until now unimaginable new life shimmering before her. She hesitated, just for a moment, then breathed deeply, because there never really was any doubt. Jeannie smiled wider than she ever had before. Oh, Harry, yes, yes, yes. Later, smuggled into his digs, she melted naked into his arms, his fingers tracing patterns down her skin, a breath of wind on silk. She closed her mind to Father's warning. Be careful. They were going to be married. It would all be fine. The next day, after Jeannie's shift in the cafe, Harry gave her some cheap thing he picked up from a pawn shop. He promised her something better. He would save up, give her the ring she deserved. Jeannie told herself she didn't care. She twirled the piece of metal, too loose, around her finger. Pewter, she reckoned, deciding to tell her parents about the engagement when Harry was back, when she had the ring he'd promised. For now, this was enough. Jeannie barely went home for the rest of the week. She threw excuse after excuse at Mother, working extra shifts, helping a friend, something for the war effort. When she wasn't at work, she was in his arms, or in his bed, or huddled together for warmth on a bench under a tree in Hyde Park, watching the ducks and the pigeons.
Useful birds, pigeons, Harry said, leaning back, head tilted, eyes trained on their bobbing heads. They carry messages undetected. You know that? Very reliable, too, long as the enemy don't shoot them down.
But they tried not to talk of the war, only their joint future. A new life afterward. They even had their photographs taken, so they could each have something of the other to hold close to their hearts while they were apart. The day Harry had to return to his USAAF station in Buckinghamshire, they said goodbye on the station platform, clinging to each other, ignoring the shouts, the footsteps, the slamming of train doors, the steam and whistles, the clunk and chug of the trains. It was just Harry, his breath warm on her skin as he murmured in her ear.
Till next time, my love,
he said, twisting Jeannie's hair around his fingers.
And while I'm away, steer clear of those darned American GIs. They can be very persuasive when it comes to pretty young things.
Oh, I'm quite immune, Jeannie said, smiling up at him. His face shimmered and blurred as tears filled her eyes. There is only one airman who will ever capture my heart. He kissed her then, long, hard, urgent. Next time, she said, even then knowing she would nudge the cheap ring from her finger into her pocket when he had gone. You must meet my parents.
Of course. Next time.
the whistle blew. Harry bounded on board, then reappeared in a window as the train heaved itself through a cloud of smoke out of the station. With a sad smile and a wave, Harry was gone. The news came one warm afternoon in late May. A narrow-faced, sandy-haired chap, tall and lanky, wearing the same uniform as Harry. He hovered outside Lion's Corner House for a while, peering through the window now and then, as though unsure whether to come in. Jeannie put down the tray of dirty crockery she was carrying and went to the door, wiping her hands on her apron. Perhaps Harry was here too. But the blood froze in her veins all the same, because somehow she already knew.
"Name's Nat. Good friend of Harry's," the man said, thrusting out his hand.
They stood for a moment in awkward silence, staring at each other, he on the doorstep, Jeannie feeling as though life itself was draining out of her, clutching at the open door.
Is there somewhere we can talk?
Jeannie turned and called to the woman behind the counter.
Okay if I go on my break just now, Margot.
She didn't wait for a reply. In the alleyway next to Lyons, Nat broke the news. Jeannie heard only his bomber went down and lost in action, and the rest was white noise as she slumped against the wall, as if her bones had all disintegrated at the impact of his words. With shaking hands, she took a drag on the cigarette Nat pushed at her and coughed her guts up as he spoke of his promise to Harry that he would tell her in person if the worst happened. How Harry talked of her all the time. How he, Nat, knew how much Jeannie meant to him. How she was the love of his life, and how sorry he was. Just so sorry.
Thank you, Nat, she managed. You've been kind to come all this way to tell me. I appreciate it, really.
Then he was gone too, shoulders sagging as he walked away. And she was all alone, a mess of tears and snot, rage and despair. She had only just found him, the love of her life too, and he'd already been wrenched away. Visions of him plummeting to his death in a burning aircraft flashed in her mind. She wrenched her meager lunch into the gutter. Jeannie sat there in the alleyway for as long as she could get away with, wondering what on earth she was going to do now. Wondering why she hadn't told her mother about him weeks ago, hadn't told a single soul. She had never felt more alone. She balled her fists and willed herself to stop crying, dried her eyes, blew her nose. She stood and heaved three ragged, deep breaths. She would find a way to cope. What choice did she have? Jeannie pushed herself off the wall and, holding her head high, walked back into the cafe to finish her shift.
Part 1. Chapter 1. Celia. April 1962. Adventurous girls of the 90s went on the stage. Between the wars, they turned to the film studios. Now it is the turn of television, the lodestar of dreamy-eyed youngsters who see themselves after 6 months as Polly Elwes or Nan Winton, or a purposeful floor manager striding about the studio with earphones and plenty of authority. Good Housekeeping's second annual careers guide for girls, November 1961.
Television. Well, wouldn't that be the thing? Celia pictures herself in a smart checked suit. Mary Quant, obviously, clipboard in hand, queen of all she surveys in the recording studio at Television Center. Dim the lighting, she commands. Camera one ready. Camera two, stand by. Actors in position, please. Cue music and... Celia, for heaven's sake, get your nose out of that magazine and eat your breakfast if you don't want to be late for work. Mother thumps a plate of bacon and eggs in front of her. If it's not a book, it's a bloomin' magazine. It's a wonder you're not boss-eyed the hours you've spent with your nose buried in print. Mother tuts, then pats Celia on the head as though to take the sting out of her words. Celia sighs and puts down the magazine, still open at the careers page. A career sounds so appealing. Celia, the career girl, an independent woman thanks to her career. She mulls the prospect over in her mind. The money, the independence, they'd be nice, especially if it came with some glamour. She could get away from Southwark, the home of the Elephant and Castle, the Shot Tower, Fish and Chips, and the original hooligan,
with its down-to-earth pubs, street markets, and gambling shops. She could live up west with the other girls, Jean Shrimpton lookalikes in a groovy flat. They'd throw impromptu parties for their cool workmates, play music, dance. It's the 1960s, after all. Girls, according to the Good Housekeeping Careers Guide, can do all sorts of jobs, from science to business to travel to television. Working in a bookshop has seemed fine for the last 3 years. She's enjoyed it. But just lately, she's been thinking it's time for a change. It's time for Celia to move up in the world. But Mother, well-meaning though she is a walking relic from the last century and doesn't believe in bettering oneself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.